Good afternoon and welcome to the City Council meeting for the City of International Falls for Monday, November the 21st. I would ask all to please arise and pledge allegiance to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation,
under God,
indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. I'd ask the City Administrator to note the roll call of the council with all members present. Move to the agenda. Council's wishes to approve the agenda.
Move.
Motion by Councilor Briggs.
I'll second.
Second by Councilor Droba. Discussion on the motion or the agenda? Question.
Aye.
I'll vote yes. Motion is carried. Agenda is approved. Thank you. Move to the minutes of the November 7 regular City Council meeting.
I'll move.
Motion by Councilor Kaler to approve.
Second.
Second by Councilor Briggs. Discussion on the motion or the minutes. Question?
Aye.
I'll vote yes. Motion is carried. Minutes for Monday, November 7th meeting are approved. And then we have the Monday, November 14th special City Council meeting for the canvassing board.
Move.
Motion by Councilor Briggs to approve.
Second.
Second by Councilor Droba. Discussion on the motion or the minutes?
Mr. Mayor, there's a correction needed in the minutes where it says on the third paragraph down under the body of the minutes, it says Mayor Anderson replied it would be manipulating the city council charter and when the vacancy occurs, etc. It wasn't what was said. What was said was I was manipulating the charter. It was an accusation that I was manipulating the charter. I listened to the tape. That was repeated twice during the course of that meeting. And I can't help but be a little sensitive about that since I was sued in court for violating the charter unsuccessfully. So I just wanted to point out that that accusation was made and I feel like I'm being bullied. And I have further statement on this that at the time of the meeting there was no city attorney present to make an appeal of the ruling of the chair. The chair called my motion out of order. It was not out of order. I could not appeal because there was no city attorney present. The issue of opening the process for appointing a vacant position isn't as important to me as the chilling effect it has on me as a participating member of this council. To be called out of order for no basis. It calls into my question ability to operate in the future. And so I am asking for a ruling on that motion that called me out of the mayor's motion or mayor's statement that I was out of order. I appeal that. And I want the minutes corrected for the accusation that was stated. And that's what I have to say about the minutes.
Thank you, Councillor. The statement I believe I made was that would be manipulating to take and have action on your motion at that time because the charter clearly calls for a resignation. We do not have a resignation as of yet. Did not at that point. And so there was no point in considering the motion.
I appeal the ruling of the chair on that particular action that I was out of order. I quote from our city attorney who wasn't present who said, I quote, "It would certainly be appropriate to take such preliminary steps, such as advertising for interested persons before the resignation, but the final selection of the replacement could not be completed until there is an actual vacancy. And I never was making a motion to make an appointment. I was making a motion to open the process. So calling that motion out of order was incorrect.
Well, earlier in his city attorney's statement, he says that regarding the appointment of the replacement, assuming he resigns that position.
That's preposterous to state, to assume that Councillor Harley, Droba, is not going to resign his position. In fact, we discussed that at the meeting, that he was going to. So that is not grounds for overruling my motion as out of order. And I just think, my contention is that when I make a motion, and I make it in good faith, and I'm representing the West Ward constituents, I expect to be treated fairly here. And I expect not to be bullied. And so I'm making that statement now.
Well, I'm sorry, it's not bullying. I am following the city charter, and the city charter says upon a resignation and the council action, and we did not have either.
The city charter says only that the appointment must be made within 60 days of the vacancy. The city charter is silent on opening up the process. It does not state anything about that. I've read the charter. I've also read the Minnesota League of Cities, who says that, you know, this literal reading of the charter, we all know a vacancy is going to occur. And in fact, the Minnesota League handbook says that councillors will be able to determine that independently by the facts of the case. And of course, we know Councillor Droba won the election and he will be vacating that seat. So to make the assumption that there's not a vacancy forthcoming is preposterous. Anyway, I don't expect to have my... Let's let this go. I want the minutes amended to show that I was accused of manipulating the charter, and secondly, I don't expect to be overruled again for no reason.
That's really, I mean, the city attorney can rule as a parliamentarian, but whether or not it's a proper ruling is up to the body.
I don't think so under Robert's Rules of Orders. You appeal the ruling of the chair to the parliamentarian, and absent a parliamentarian, I would assume it was the city attorney. We have a parliamentarian, Mr. Mayor? We are following Robert's Rules of Orders, right?
I assume the city attorney could fill that role. I don't know that I've ever experienced that he has had to.
Well, I've never had the experience of being ruled out of order either.
Well, I think you have. I believe there's other occasions when that has occurred.
Yeah, well, I'm tired of being bullied.
Minutes are before us.
Make a motion to approve the minutes with the correction I stated.
We have a motion already to approve the minutes.
Make a motion to amend the minutes with a corrected statement of what was actually said.
Accept your motion.
I'll second for discussion.
Motion seconded to amend the motion.
That's what was said. I have no issue with that. I don't recall that being the exact words. I have no issue with amending them if that is what's said. But either way, I don't want to stay here all night on this one particular piece of approving minutes. But the reality is I can't recall what the actual wording was unless we were to look at the video.
Which I did.
And that's fine. I'm not saying you hadn't, but I would, if we're going to amend those, I think we should have the city administrator look at it, make sure that that's what it was said. If that's the case, then we amend them.
Well, I'm not lying, but yeah.
I'm not saying you are. I'm just...
Mr. Mayor, I might suggest that if Councillor Jaxa was offering a motion to revise the minutes, that it might be appropriate to have specifically what language should be inserted in here.
Mayor replied, you are manipulating the city charter. wasn't it would be manipulating. It was an assertion that I was trying to manipulate the city charter. That's different. And again, I'm pretty sensitive about that since I've been accused of violating the city charter through a lawsuit.
So, Mr. Mayor, please. So the revision, Councilor Jackson, would be instead of it reading Mayor Anderson replied it would be manipulating the city charter, you're suggesting it would read Mayor Anderson replied, quote, you are manipulating the city charter.
You are trying to manipulate the city charter. That is what was said twice. I was paying close attention, by the way, so I really didn't need to watch the video, but that was said twice in the video in exactly those words.
Mr. Mayor, I presume that the motion has been made, and assuming that the seconder agrees with the change, then council would have to vote on the amendment to the minutes, and then if that's approved, vote on the minutes approval with the amendment.
Yes. Okay, we have the amendment. Further discussion with regard to the amendment?
Mr. Mayor,
please.
As long as that's what the tape says, I'm okay with that.
I'm also.
I would hope city administrator go back at the tape and make sure that's what it says.
Further discussion? Question.
Aye.
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 Oh, yes. Motion is carried to amend the minutes, and that will be done by the city administrator upon reviewing those minutes. And then we have the main motion to approve the city council meeting minutes as amended. Question.
Aye.
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 And I'll vote yes. Motion is carried. Minutes are approved as amended. Thank you. Then move to the finances, and we have three transfers. Two fund to the general fund from the water and sewer fund, $17,715. To the permanent improvement fund, $16,668. And to the reserve for capital outlay from the water and sewer fund, $17,428. We have accounts payable claims of $294,368.67. Airport commission claims of $22,740.01. Library board claims of $5,001.24. Your pleasure with the transfers and the accounts payable.
I'll move.
Motion by Councilor Kaler to adopt the resolution.
Second.
Second by Councilor Drova. Discussion on the motion or the resolution? Question.
Aye.
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 And I'll vote yes. Motion is carried. Resolution is adopted. Transfers and payment of claims are approved. Thank you. Go to the audience. Anyone that wishes to approach the council at this time that is not on the agenda? Yes, please.
I know we're going to discuss in a few minutes about the parking in front of Bacchus.
That will be up.
But I do have a concern also because I live on the corner of 10th Avenue and 5th Street, and my driveway to my garage is right on that avenue, and I cannot back out of my driveway into the street or when there's the Ruby's Pantry. I was just wondering if maybe somebody could consider right behind my driveway to maybe put a yellow line so at least I can get out of my driveway. There's an alley right by the church and just enough room so I can back out.
Which corner of the 10th Avenue and 5th Street are you in?
I'm right straight across from Faith United.
So you would be in the southeast corner then?
Yeah.
And so you would
find people parking there, but I can't get out.
So you would ask for no parking from the corner of 10th Avenue going up to your driveway?
No. Just right straight back out of my driveway on the church side.
Right.
Where the alley is.
On the 10th Avenue side?
Yes, on 10th Avenue.
I see.
Just so I can back out of the driveway. Because I have a really hard time if Rudy's Pantry parked up to my driveway and they're parked behind my driveway, I have no way to get out.
We can put down Public Works agenda.
Yes. Yeah.
Thank you.
I would refer that to the Public Works Infrastructure Committee to review. And so we will have that further. Can I get your name, please?
Laura, L-A-U-R-A-N-T-Y.
Thank you. Further from the audience, anyone that wishes to approach the council that's not on the agenda? Be another opportunity at the conclusion of the meeting for audience participation. With that, we would go to the second reading of Ordinance 18 of the fifth series, and that's to amend the conditions of approval of the alley vacation in Block E as established in the Ordinance Number 370, approved April the 5th of 1954. Council's pleasure with the second reading of the ordinance.
Move.
Motion by Councillor Briggs to approve.
I'll second.
Second by Councillor Droba. Discussion? Question?
Aye.
I'll vote yes. Motion is carried. Second reading is approved. Thank you. We have the first reading of the Ordinance 19 of the fifth series to amend Section 2-52 of the Code of Ordinances related to the residency requirements for certain city employees for job-related necessity, specifically for firefighters and ambulance attendants. And this would allow a little more latitude in the response time by those individuals, deleting the words 6 minute and inserting the words 8 minutes, so there'd be a little more leeway in response time. The council's pleasure with the first reading of that ordinance.
I'll move.
Motion by Councillor Kaler to approve.
Second.
Second by Councillor Droba. Discussion on the motion or the ordinance? Question?
Aye.
Oh, yes. Motion is carried and the first reading is approved. Thank you. Go to old business, and we have the resolution to approve the Public Works and Infrastructure Committee recommendation to restrict parking on the north side of 5th Street between 9th and 10th Avenues. Is there a motion to take that from the table for consideration?
So moved.
Motion by Councillor Briggs.
Second.
Second by Councillor Droba. Motion is to take it from the table for consideration. Question?
Aye.
I'll vote yes. Motion is carried. And the resolution is now before us. And the representatives from the Bacchus Board, Sherry and Waugh, do you want to make any statements this evening? Did your board have an opportunity to discuss it?
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought I had read that clearly.
Your paper.
Very good. Thank you. So we have the Bacchus Board is supporting that. And I also had a call from a homeowner today living on the south side that is in support of that resolution, but also expressed a concern in eliminating that parking. Would it increase the speed on the street? And was concerned about that for folks that are crossing the street there. Just a note. So your pleasure with that resolution then?
I have a question.
Do we have a motion to?
I'll move.
Motion by Councillor Droba to adopt the resolution.
Second.
Second by Councillor Kaler.
Point of information.
Counselor, please.
Point of information. Are we going to allow drop-off parking there? I thought we were.
Yes, that's okay. What the recommendation was to make it a drop-off zone. Okay. Eliminate the parking.
That's what I thought, yeah.
To the letter that Citizens for Bacchus had wrote, one of the things that they were, as I understood it, that they were hoping for is that it would be 24-hour no parking zone, and that vehicles that were left overnight would be ticketed. Would that be an issue to make sure that we, at least in the beginning, make sure that this is highly enforced so that people understand that they can't be parking there?
That would be a problem.
Okay.
And I had a constituent call me last week too, and that, like I mentioned before, about extending it farther to 8th Avenue. Actually, this lady would be even east of 8th Avenue on 5th Street with the same problem like the lady there has with parking and getting it out. So if you'd want to add that to your Public Works meeting to maybe discuss further having just parking on one side of the street, because the streets are narrow all the way there. And for the segment,
in front of St. Thomas?
In front of St. Thomas, then even across another block, even east. Because they're
from 7th Avenue yeah, to 9th Avenue?
Yeah, 7th Avenue to 9th Avenue.
And for the record, we did have discussion about the St. Thomas side, but the conversation came up for election parking and handicap parking, but it's definitely something we can revisit.
Thank you.
That will be also before the Public Works Committee. Further questions or discussions with regard to the resolution to restrict parking?
How long would that take to enforce?
Once the council moves tonight, the Public Works Department can put the signs up that would say no parking, drop-off only. And
paint the line at all?
I don't know that we can do any painting in this kind of weather, and I think probably the curb might be covered with ice right now. So, yes, please.
Yes, in my letter it was stating something about you will need to continue parking regulations. Only allow parking on the south side of 5th Street on odd days of the week throughout the year. I've lived at my house since 1999. I've never seen any odd or even day parking. So is that a valid point?
No, I think that once we eliminate the parking on one side, we would still allow parking all the time on the south side.
Just want to clarify.
I know that we have calendar parking, but we should probably include, just to be clear, that the calendar parking wouldn't be enforced on the south side of the street.
I saw Ken's eyes go up, so I knew that we were doing something he didn't like.
Well, Mr. Mayor, Council, I just raised my eyes because I sent the letter. I know that we have the calendar parking ordinance, and so if we're making an exception to that, I'd have to be a change to the ordinance for that specific street, but I'll consult with the city attorney in the...
If we include in the motion that we're not going to enforce parking on that side, yes, we may have to go back and look at the ordinance, but I believe that we have not been enforcing it. Further discussion? Further questions? None. Question.
Aye.
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 No vote yes. Motion is carried. Resolution is adopted and parking will be restricted. Thank you. The consent agenda, which includes licenses, Carlson's Auto Repair, gasoline pump license, City Cab and Van Service Incorporated, taxi license, DNS Pizza Incorporated, doing business as Domino's Pizza, a restaurant license, Duty Free Americas, gasoline pumps license, Forestland Sales and Service Incorporated, doing business as Pizza Barn, a restaurant license, Icebox Investments, LLC, doing business as Dairy Queen International Falls, a restaurant license, the Yoga Bear massage therapy license. Pleasure with the consent agenda.
I'll move.
Motion by Councilor Kaler to approve.
Second.
Second by Councilor Droba. Question?
Aye.
I'll vote yes. Motion is carried. Consent agenda is approved. Thank you. We'll move to new business. Item number one is to approve the 2017 license renewals. Again, we will take those that have liquor in them individually. Bootleggers Fuel and Liquor Incorporated, doing business at Bootleggers Fuel and Liquor, restaurant license, gasoline pumps license, cigarette license, and 3-2 off-sale license. Motion by Councilor Droba to approve.
Second.
Second by Councilor Briggs. Discussion? Question?
Aye.
And I'll vote yes. Motion is carried. Licenses are approved. And I assume, Chief, that if you have any points on any of these, that you would raise that on any of the licenses for liquor?
Right.
Thank you. The second one is also for Bootleggers Liquor LLC, and that's an off-sale liquor license.
I'll move.
Motion by Councilor Kaler.
Second.
Second by Councilor Droba. Discussion? Question?
Aye.
I'll vote yes. Motion is carried. License is approved. Citizens for Bacchus AB, a restaurant license, wine on sale license, and 3-2 on sale with the restaurant license.
Move.
Motion by Councilor Briggs to approve.
Second.
Second by Councilor Droba. Discussion? Question?
Aye.
I'll vote yes. Motion is carried. Licenses are approved. DJ Retail LLC, doing business as Dollar General Store number 15619, a cigarette license.
Move.
Second.
Motion by Councilor Droba, second by Councilor Briggs to approve. Discussion? Question?
Aye.
I'll vote yes. Motion is carried. License is approved. Forestland Sales and Service Incorporated, doing business as Forestland Sales and Service, a cigarette license and gasoline pump license.
I'll move.
Motion by Councilor Kaler to approve.
Second.
Second by Councilor Droba. Discussion? Question?
Aye.
Yes, motion is carried and license is approved. Hanson's Outpost Incorporated, a cigarette license, off-sale liquor license, on-sale liquor license, Sunday liquor license, restaurant license, amusement games, pool table, and jukebox licenses.
I'll move.
Motion by Councilor Droba to approve.
I'll second.
Second by Councilor Kaler. Discussion?
Mr. Mayor.
Please.
I had a question. I realize all of our licenses are to enforce the laws given to them. Am I correct in that?
Yes, sir.
Really, we have to enforce amusement games, pool tables, jukeboxes as a city? I'm not against it. It just seems rather silly, especially when they're $15 and $20 licenses. I have no issue with it. It's just something that I think maybe we could do without, but just my thought. We can move on.
Interesting point
license,
to raise.
License and legislation, I think, should consider.
Are you suggesting that we raise the fee?
No. Get rid of it. Maybe at the next land use and legislation we'll take it up, but as of right now, I'm not even asking. Just pointing the point that is kind of silly, honestly.
Further discussion? Question?
Aye.
I'll vote yes. Motion is carried. License is approved for Hanson's Outpost. IH Stewart Incorporated, doing business as Super One, a restaurant license and a cigarette license.
Move.
Motion by Councilor Briggs.
Second.
Second by Councilor Kaler. Discussion? Question?
Aye.
I'll vote yes. Motion carries 4 with 1 abstention. License is approved. Thank you. Randy's Tire and Auto Repair LLC, a restaurant license, gasoline pump license, and cigarette license.
I'll move.
Motion by Counselor Droba.
I'll second.
Second by Counselor Kaler. Discussion? Question?
Aye.
Aye.
I'll vote yes. Motion is carried. License is approved. Thank you. TRM Second Incorporated, doing business as Chocolate Moose Restaurant Company, a restaurant license and wine on sale license.
Second.
Motion by Counselor Briggs, second by Counselor Droba. Discussion? Question?
Aye.
I'll vote yes. Motion is carried. License is approved. Thank you. Timber Pins LLC, doing business as Timber Pins, a restaurant license, a bowling alley license, pool table license, Sunday liquor license, and on sale liquor license. Motion by Counselor Droba.
Second.
Second by Counselor Kaler. Discussion? Question?
Aye.
I'll vote yes. Motion is carried. License is approved for Timber Pins. Thank you. And Menards, number 3507, a fireworks license.
I'll move.
Motion by Counselor Kaler to approve.
Second.
Second by Counselor Briggs. Discussion? Question?
Aye.
I'll vote yes. Motion is carried. Fireworks license is approved. Thank you. Go to item two under new business, and that's request for the city's support activities for the 13th annual Arrowhead Ultra 135, scheduled for January 30th. Ken and Jackie Krieger. Thank you.
It's that time of year again.
Hi, so this will be the 13th annual Arrowhead Ultra 135, and it's our fourth year running it. This year we have 182 racers from 30 different states, 6 countries, 4 provinces. And we limit the amount of participants we have because one of our things is solitude on the trail. So we fill up very quickly. And in the past years, the city's helped us, and we're basically requesting the same help again this year. So we have our starting at Cary Park Arena. We start at 7 o'clock Monday, January 30th. So if we can use the arena, that works out excellent for us starting. We typically have a race banner hung over 3rd Street by Smoky Bear Park. The police cover the first couple rail crossing or road crossings. We typically get a megaphone from the fire department just for that morning starting. And that there might be fireworks at the start.
Yes, Fire Chief has agreed to secure a couple of cannons to start the race.
So, that sounds great.
In the darkness of January the 30th morning.
I feel sorry for the people sleeping.
Oh, I think most people are up by 7 o'clock.
So in a different world than I do.
So, council's pleasure with approving the those requests.
I'll make a motion to approve those requests. Thank you for doing.
Motion by Councilor Jackson.
Second.
Second by Councilor Briggs. Discussion. Question.
Aye.
Well, yes. Motion is carried. Thank you for your great work in organizing this event. It brings a lot of folks to the community and also great notoriety.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Item number three under new business is a resolution of the International Falls Area Chamber of Commerce opposing municipal ordinances affecting employer benefits for employees. And that resolution was adopted by the International Falls Area Chamber of Commerce. John, were you going to speak to this one or no?
No, nope, the next agenda item. That was just for your information.
Just information. All right. Thank you. Item number four is the approval of the Icebox Days events as requested by the International Falls Area Chamber of Commerce.
Run that again this year?
Thank you, Mayor and Council members. Thank you for putting us on your agenda this evening. We have, representing the Chamber, Icebox Days Festival, the Freezer Gizzle Blizzard Run in the audience today. We have Linda Torseth and Betsy Zarin. We also have my wingmate from the Chamber, Ashley Farmer. And this is Haley Silvers, who is an avid runner in our community and is helping us to revamp the race course. So we're here for a few things tonight. Number one is for the assistance that you so graciously provide the Chamber for Icebox Days. We're asking for that same assistance this year. And also for fireworks, which we have done in the past, and that's that Saturday, January 21st at Smoky Bear Park at 6 p.m. That's delightful. They're requesting that again. And also we want to come before you this evening to advise that between the Freezer Gizzle Blizzard Run, the Chamber Board of Directors, and some runners in our community, i.e. Haley, and other runners, we've redesigned the 10K and the 5K. So I think I'll let Haley explain that. I know everybody has a handout in front of them, compliments of Ken, the 5K and 10K race routes.
Myself and another board that I sit on, we've talked a lot about how it would be nice to have Icebox Days be in more central location. For the most part, the entire Icebox Days is downtown. The start and finish and the whole congregation of the race is at RCC. So we wondered how we could make the start and the finish be closer to the Icebox festivities. And so we entertained the idea of having it at Bacchus. We feel really confident in that. And so I've worked on adjusting the course so that it will work there. We have a map here, and if we can look at 9th Avenue as if it was the college driveway. Let's just pretend 9th Avenue is the college driveway, and we can have our start-finish line there. And we would head west on Highway 1171. And really, the 10K route can stay very similar to what it is right now. We can go past the college to 107. We'll have a turnaround spot on old Highway 11 there where we come back up on, I don't know my streets, but the McDonald's Road, hit 53, and head back to Bacchus. That route is pretty much the same. There's very little adjusting that needs to change there. But the 5K will change. And we think that it'll be an even nicer transition. Really, they're going to leave from the exact same place, out 9th Avenue, turn west. But when we get to 11th Street, we'll just let them cut down 11th Street, get up to Highway 53, get right back on the course again and finish in the same direction that the 10K runners finish. So really the 5K is on the exact same route with the exception of 11th Street, just sort of splitting that route in half. I've already tracked them numerous times. The 5K, I have it down to 3.1 and the 10K, 6.2.
Question that I have with regard to the 10K route, did you say it was going to come back to McDonald's? Were you talking about 17th Street or 20th?
Oh, I apologize. Yeah, it's not that road. It's I'm sorry.
It's the one. It's the one further.
Yeah, 20th Street.
Okay.
Thank you.
Right.
Yeah,
that's what you have here. But
here.
I thought I heard you say McDonald's. And
that's the one. Yes. Okay. Yes.
We'll go by McDonald's.
It's pretty darn close.
Pretty close, yeah. So it goes from 107 and then to 114.
Crosses right into 20th Street.
Correct.
Because
yes.
That's now across, the map doesn't reflect it, but it,
yes.
But it all joins together.
And it won't cross seamlessly. Just as last year, we will have a turnaround point on that 11th Avenue there. So we will turn down 11th Avenue, and then we'll come back and get on 114. And that's what we did for the last several years.
Okay.
That'll stay the same.
Mr. Chairman, could I back up a little bit and share what you and I spoke about on the phone about the transition from the college, just to bring everybody up to
yes,
speed?
Yes, please.
Yeah.
Icebox Days is being rebranded. A few months ago, the Chamber Board said that they were willing to move forward on rebranding Icebox Days. And coincidentally, last year, Jim and Mel Woods, who have a, has a friend who is an artist for rock star bands, makes posters. Just for fun, Jim and Mel did a poster last year for Icebox Days. It was this. And so it kind of caught on to folks, and it, Jim and Mel approached us and said, well, do you think the Chamber would rebrand Icebox Days as a means of growing it? Because there really isn't one particular image that is communicated. So we brought this to the Chamber Board, and they were receptive to it. And at the same time, there was the idea of, well, perhaps there needs to be a transition of the Blizzard Run, which is considered the anchor event for Icebox Days. And the Convention and Visitors Bureau, our partners Pete and Ashley, and their board of directors had said, we want to contribute some advertising dollars to help promote the Blizzard Run, because we also believe it's the anchor event. So they're contributing $2,500 for promoting the Blizzard Run. So one thing led to another, and we thought, well, if we're rebranding Icebox Days, maybe we need to look at the Blizzard Run. And I know Linda is the chair of our Freezer Gives a Blizzard Run committee, and she had said before, and I know Betsy when she was chamber president before, there have been attempts and thoughts of having the race start and finish at Bacchus. But the timing just wasn't right. 1 year, 5K happened, but it wasn't in conjunction with the 10K, so it just wasn't the right timing for it. So we know how precious of a relationship the Blizzard Run has with the community college. So I was very nervous. I didn't want to even approach the subject without going to my superiors, the Chamber Board of Directors. So I went to the Board of Directors first before I went to the Blizzard Run Committee and to some of the runners in the community. The Board of Directors put their blessing on it for in the name of growing the Freezer Gives a Blizzard Run and Icebox Days. Then I took it to the Freezer Gives a Blizzard Run Committee, and they put their blessing on it a week ago. So we contacted Carol Helland, the provost at Rainy River Community College, because we certainly do not want to have the college feel like the rug is being taken out from underneath their feet, because the race has been there since day one, 1980, and we're in our 37th year. And if it weren't for the college, quite frankly, this race wouldn't be at the number that it is. They've been an incredible host. They've been an incubator for us, and they've been a partner all these years. So we had to approach this with Carol's blessing. And so I visited with her and shared with her the thought process on it. Last year, the runner's reception was at Bacchus Community Center because they have a 3-2 license for beer. They have the permission to do beer and wine. So we thought we'd have the runner's reception there because there's enough space. So this year, the Freezer Gives a Blizzard Run Committee in their very first meeting said, well, if we're going to have the runner's reception there, let's have the award ceremony there for 5K and 10K. And then so we're kind of inching our way over to Bacchus for those kinds of things. We don't have always the promise of showers at the college because of their game schedule and their gymnasium. And we don't have abundant restrooms at the college. And so we're kind of outgrowing it a little bit. So in speaking with Carol, we told her about this and this vision. And because we so much cherish our relationship with the college, we want the college to be a big part of Icebox Days. So what we're going to be doing is the college is going to be on our runner shirts. They're going to have materials inside our registration bags to promote the college, because that's one of the reasons we wanted it at the college many, many years ago, I was told, is because the college is such an asset, and what a great way to promote the college with all these visitors to the area would be right there at the college witnessing firsthand. Oh, they have a community college there. And then also we have invited them to have a booth at the Wellness Expo. And also our honorary race directors, Dick Ostroot and Bob Connor. Everyone knows Dick Ostroot, but Bob Connor is the one runner of the entire Blizzard Run who's run every year. So Bob Connors and Dick Ostroot are going to be our co-race directors, and we're getting a special award for Rainy River Community College to be shared at the very beginning of the award ceremony. So they're going to receive special recognition. And we want to keep them tied closely to this run because they help birth it. And so we were nervous about that, but Carol, the provost of the college, said she appreciated our approach. She thought it was well thought out. She appreciates the gesture of involving them in the Blizzard Run as we move forward. So we're hopeful that that relationship will just continue to blossom in other ways. And I wanted to back up and tell you that. At Bacchus, we have other events that are happening there. We have the turkey bowling. We have abundant bathrooms. We have the showers. We have an area for packet pickup and registration, an area for the expo. There's a pasta feed that Bacchus does on Friday night before the race. It's for the runners and the public, so the public will be able to integrate with the runners.
And the concert.
Yeah, and there's also a concert that night, too. Blind Joe was playing. So it's kind of an epic center. So we had to make this transition, but we had to do so very methodically. Just wanted to bring you up to speed on that.
Great.
So we are asking for your blessing, and I did speak to Chief Maston this morning about the routes, and he said he'd help in any way appropriate. And so we're just asking for your blessing of these new routes. If we need to meet with a committee, the Infrastructure and Public Works Committee, or another meeting with the chief, what we're looking for is just some traffic control, and we're looking for the sanding of both the 5K and the 10K the morning of the race. And we'll probably need your recommendations, Chief, on traffic control, some serious areas. And
I'm assuming you'll have a lot of volunteers.
Yeah, we'll have a lot of volunteers. Yes, the Freezer Gives a Blizzard Run Committee is phenomenal. And then the Rotary Club also volunteers, and then a few other people volunteer. And the Community Wellness Action Council will be volunteering as well. So we'll just need a lot of cones and orange vests, but we can probably get our hands on orange vests. And we have signage right now from the old course. We're going to do an inventory after the Christmas parade is over. We're going to take out all the Blizzard Run signs and see what new signs we need to have made for the new route.
So the request for fireworks and then the race route assistance, and I assume that includes now the closing of 9th Avenue from 3rd Street to 5th Street?
Correct.
Because that's where you would start both races?
Yes.
Correct.
Yep. So we would need to barricade those areas.
Yes.
Okay. And that's for just that morning for the races, because it'll start and finish there.
We'll start and finish there, and like you said, up to 5th to 3rd should be plenty of those two blocks. And I forget what time the race starts and the last
9:30 a.m. is when the 5K starts, and then 10:30 a.m. is when the 10K is that right, Linda?
From 9 a.m. to noon, really, it needs to be just closed off.
So the council understands that would be barricading 9th Avenue from 3rd Street to 5th Street from about 9 a.m. to noon. Council's pleasure with those requests?
Move.
Motion by Councilor Briggs.
Second.
Second by Councilor Droba to approve. Discussion or further questions? Question.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Thank you.
Vote yes, motion is carried, and the approval is given for those.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you
so much. Thank you.
Thank you for the good work and bringing this another year.
Thank you very much.
Item number 5 is the Convention and Visitors Bureau Annual Report. Pete Schultz and Ashley.
And seeing some reports, and I brought some copies if there's anyone in the audience that would like to have them. There are some others here that I'll leave up out front. What the heck? I just handed off all of them. I didn't know there was going to be so many. But if you want additional copies of the information, it's not super. You can come down to the CBD office and we'd happily run out some copies for you. With that, we have a PowerPoint presentation. We've entered the modern times. And so we'll try to give you a brief and informative update. Tourism is a key part of our local economy.
So Briggs, can you see?
The Department of Revenue and Department of Employment and Economic Development's latest figures are for 2014. The statistics show Cochise County saw gross sales of nearly $30 million in leisure and hospitality, which generated nearly $1.9 billion in sales tax and provided 578 private sector jobs. The CBD works toward increasing all those numbers, and we're here with an update on what we're doing and planning, and we also want to hear from you. Your input is always welcome. Appreciate the lodging operators and others that serve on our board, and your information packets include a board roster, so you can contact any board member that you wish to provide your input, and that's what our meetings are. Also contact our offices. You know me, I'm Pete Schultz, and seated to my right is Ashley Farmer, our administrative assistant, who's been with us since last spring, and she's been doing a great job of helping the CVB and also the Chamber of Commerce. We share Ashley as an administrative assistant. Presentation is a thumbnail sketch, but you have the information packets that include much more detailed information. Start by presenting information on lodging tax collection. So far this year, International Falls lodging tax has remitted a total of $52,722. That's $12,281 more than last year at this time. Rainy Lake lodging taxes are at $44,850 compared to $40,194 at this time last year, $1,656. That translates to about $500,000 in spending on lodging. Rainier did not post an increase over last year, but they also saw two vacation homes and several other lodging options removed from their inventory this past summer. I'll show you how we've been promoting the area. Your packets include a spreadsheet showing the 2016 marketing budget and the proposed 2017 plan. The proposed marketing is in red. We worked with Midwest Outdoors on a campaign that included sponsoring the TV show and markets throughout the upper Midwest, and we're hoping to show you the spot.
This year, make Rainy Lake your vacation destination. Rainy Lake is Minnesota's vacation paradise, a world-class fishing destination, and home to Blue Angels National Park. Fish in a wilderness setting unlike anything you have ever seen. Choose from resorts, motels, houseboats, or Voyagers National Park's reservation-only boat-in tent camping sites located throughout the park. Call the International Falls Convention and Visitors Bureau at 1-800-FALLS-MN or visit rainylake.org for your vacation of a lifetime.
Along with the TV spot, which aired on all their shows in the upper Midwest, Midwest Outdoors promotion package also included articles in their magazine and a four-color full-size ad you see in the corner there in the print ads. And online promotions with Midwest Outdoors included banner ads on their website and postings to Facebook and segments featuring Rainy Lake that were posted on YouTube. And Rainy Lake was also featured in their May e-newsletter. This would be the piece on Rainy Lake that appeared on YouTube. Print ads in Minnesota Outdoor News throughout the year with a heavy concentration in the spring. The ads appeared in issues that were distributed at sports shows and at the state fair. The ads promoted ice fishing, the extended spring walleye season, and summer fishing. We're now promoting ice fishing in those ads once again. Our Minnesota Tourism Co-op program to place ads in Roadrunner magazine appealing to motorcycling tourists. Roadrunner has subscribers from all over the United States and Canada, and the magazine is also available at retail outlets. Another EMT co-op program placed our ad in a section of Snowblower devoted to sliding in Minnesota. Snowblower is distributed in Michigan, Wisconsin, and Minnesota. Also sponsored printing the Voyager Country Trail Society snowmobile map with an ad panel in 2016, and we're doing the same for 2017. Speaking of snowmobiling, we cooperated with the other Voyagers National Park Gateway communities on an ad that appeared in the Destinations issue of Minnesota Snowmobiling. It was a two-page spread with ads from all the Gateway communities. The Destination issue is used as a response piece to snowmobiling inquiries by Explore Minnesota Tourism. The two-page spread and ad repeated this past October. We cooperated with the other Gateway communities on a Destination Voyagers National Park half-page ad that appeared in AAA's Home and Away magazine last May. It included a sidebar story on Voyagers National Park. The CVB will be doing a similar spread in the May-June issue this spring, which will have a feature article on the park, and we'll have a half-page ad and a half-page of advertorial.
AAA Living Magazine and full-page EMT ads, EMT being Explore Minnesota Tourism, not emergency medical treatment. These are promoting biking in the spring and fall colors in September, and we did get quite a few responses to those ads. There are marketing efforts that go on throughout the year. We post a current report on our website, and that post serves as a blog. It's one of the most visited pages on the site. An e-newsletter we've been producing for about 2 years continues to gather new subscribers, and the numbers show solid participation. Participating in Facebook for many years and continue to grow a following there. We have better than 8,000 likes, total reach of 15,229, and several thousand people check out each post that appears on Facebook. Banners, which include a handy pull-out map and info guide. We've gotten some nice comments on the new guide. Our brochures are distributed at all Minnesota Travel Information Centers and at cooperating chambers and CVBs. Also distributed locally along with the handy maps. Travel information centers are represented by the yellow information symbol on that map, which I guess is kind of small from where you're seated, but there are quite a few of them. We've included a spreadsheet to show the distribution of the past planner. We started distributing that book in August of 2011 and sent the last of them out in September. In all, we distributed 60,000 of those vacation planners. The most important requests for information are the ones that come directly to our office, and those are increasing. In fact, the October e-newsletter mentioned the new book was available and provided a link so people could go directly to the request form, and 21 people did exactly that. That's part of the increase of 17 to 46 comparing October of last year to October of this year. Also included a general marketing calendar showing 2016, 2017, and 2018 promotions as they're planned now. Plans that are set and contracts signed are in black. Proposed promotions are in red. And the sidebar shows full year promotions such as the ads we place in Explore Minnesota Tourism Statewide Guide or our presence in the Arrowhead Region promotions prepared by the Minnesota Arrowhead Association or our website brochures in the rack at the Minneapolis-St. Paul International Airport, participation in social media, and our regular e-newsletter. In addition to the marketing we have planned, we're also working with Voyager Country ATV to establish safe, legal, marked trails to connect all the gateway communities for Voyager's National Park. We're also part of the Northern Trails Task Force to interconnect other types of trails and identify opportunities for specialty trails such as mountain biking or birding or another growing one, fat tire biking. Operation of that type extends to the Voyage Forward effort, where a destiny driver for tourism has been working with local businesses and attractions to be sure they're listed on various free web services and especially on the National Geographic Heart of the Continent tourism site. We're also working with a fairly new Minnesota magazine called Lake Times, which is a very nice publication. They'll feature International Falls, Rainier, and Rainy Lake as their lake town for the winter 2017 issue, and the editor is considering returning to do another feature during the summer. She was impressed with everything we have to offer. Promotions reach a varied audience, but we do try to target the age and recreation groups where our message will have a strong appeal. We've surveyed lodging operators and visitors, and the surveys tell us that most of our visitors are in the age range of 35 to 60. Most are here because of the national park, and they're here to fish, boat, canoe, or take part in any of their other outdoor recreations available. The majority of our visitors are from Minnesota, the metro area specifically. Most of the rest come from one of the neighboring states, but we do have guests from all over North America sign our guest book, as well as a couple dozen people from overseas each summer. We also review Facebook, Google Analytics, Webstats, and results from our e-newsletter to get better insight into who we should be targeting. One of the marketing firms that we work with suggested we provide an incentive to sign up for our e-newsletter on the website, and we're now in the process of offering a coupon for discounted lodging that can be used during the show. It will be emailed with a welcome message as people sign up on our site for the e-newsletter. That's a real quick look at what we've been doing and working on. If you have any questions, we'd be happy to try and answer them. If you have any input, you're welcome to contact board members or our offices directly and provide that input. Questions?
have two.
Yes,
Councilor
Grobe.
Come on. All right. Going through that, all your marketing looks absolutely fantastic, but the one thing that I found really interesting is, are you targeting by Facebook using actual Facebook target ads or YouTube target ads? Because you have your demographic of the 30 to 60 year old fishing, hunting in Minnesota, the metro. You could literally have your ad pop up right on their stuff in the metro area, and it would cost you less than $5 a week.
Actually, we spend $500 a month on ads for Facebook to target specific people.
Excellent.
And yes, we can specifically, geographically,
absolutely
target people, and we believe that it's worth.
My second question is, I saw your members are up. Do you think that that's due to the new regulations on how fast the places have to pay, or is it just because we're getting a lot more people?
It's probably a factor of both. Certainly, we can't say that every business saw increased lodging sales, but most of them saw some increases in lodging sales. And the city changing the formula of the collections has made it more of an even thing now, so we're able to look at month to month what the lodging tax collections would be. What you're seeing in these figures we're presenting can be skewed by the factor that some of these lodging tax payments have been late, and sometimes as much as 90 days late.
I think you guys are doing amazing work. That is very, very good work. Awesome.
Further questions?
I like the logo. The logo is very nice.
Yes. We've received some nice comments on the logo as well.
Yeah. Well, that's a geotagging logo too, isn't it? Where people can actually tag that onto their own pictures on social media? Because I've seen it up on other people's stuff. So. Absolutely. Great work.
Well done. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for the presentation.
There you go.
And I got to say thank you, Ashley, because without Ashley,
we wouldn't have that slideshow.
Maybe stick drawings.
They would have been good stick drawings.
Yeah.
Thank you again.
You may proceed.
Thank you.
Move to item number 6 on the new business agenda, and that's approve the 2017 letter of agreement with Key Advocates Incorporated for the Highway 53 Task Force. This is in cooperation with St. Louis and Coochin Counties. Each pay $4,000 for the support of their work in Washington on Highway 53. Pleasure with that.
I'll move. I want to ask questions.
Motion by Councilor Droba.
Second.
Second by Councilor Briggs. Discussion.
When it's asking for $4,000 per entity, is that City of International Falls, that's the county puts in another $4,000, everyone's putting in
$4,000? St. Louis County, each entity puts in $4,000.
So are there other cities that are putting in $4,000 other than International Falls?
At one time, Virginia was putting in monies, and they have dropped out. But the four entities were the only ones that were. But now there's just the three. And that has been that way for the past 7 years, 8 years.
My concern is that we never get a report. We don't know what value we're getting here. I haven't heard from the Highway 53 Task Force. We spend money on these efforts, but we never get any feedback on what's happening. I feel like I'm throwing money into an empty hole. Secondly, I don't know if it's appropriate that the city of International Falls, being the only city, is making this contribution.
Well, probably 60 to 70% of the visitors to International Falls come up Highway 53. I think we've seen great improvements to Highway 53 over the past 12 years. And I will try to do better in getting reports to you. The reason for wanting to continue another year is that Transportation Committee is looking at the possibility of additional funding being available in 2017. As well, the new administration is talking about increased spending in infrastructure, and we're hoping to be able to secure additional funds for passing lanes on the remaining 70 miles that is not four lane at this time.
Was this in conjunction with the project that's going to be moving forward to the old Giovanni's building, or is this a separate entity?
This is separate. The Gateway Corridor is a separate project with MnDOT. This would be including federal funding for highway improvements. Highway 53 is a U.S. highway. Further questions or discussion?
Mr. Chairman.
Please.
You had mentioned this for passing lanes. Have we pretty much given up that we're going to get four lane from Cook to here?
It's difficult to right now to justify. I think we've seen the amount of truck traffic decrease on 53. At one time, there was a very, very high volume of trucking coming out of Canada into the U.S. With the close down of the Fort Frances mill, we've seen that decline. Also, there's a mill in Kenora and Dryden have reduced, and so we're not seeing the truck traffic that we once did there. Although 53 is attracting some trucks from the west because they find the highway very easy to traverse, it's just not seeing the numbers that we were previously. And so I think to justify four lane is going to be more difficult now than it was previously. Further questions?
And this is for 1 year?
Yes, for 1 year.
Okay.
Further discussion? Question?
Aye.
No. I'll vote yes. Motion carries four and one against.
And I was really close to no.
I could tell.
Thank you.
Put it on anyway.
We'll go to reports of boards, committees, and department heads. City administrator.
I have none.
Thank you. City attorney.
Nothing special, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Chief Maston? Thank you. And we do have a report by our building inspector, Kelly, if you'd like to come forth and review that with us. Got to move so it picks up your voice.
Basically, what we have is a quarterly report ended in the 1st of October, so I'm a little behind with this report, so it's a little bit confusing. If you look at the graph on the bottom, you'll see the high peak in the green there ended at the end of September. So we're kind of a little bit behind the ball with my report, and it just threw conflicts. One thing that you'll notice, though, that in the third quarter from 2014, at the beginning there, is our numbers are up considerably from what they were in the past. The nice part is this does not reflect to the airport project. This is actually a residential projects throughout homes. You do have the addition of the Tim Hortons building and some of the commercial aspects that we've did in the downtown area through the grant program through Kutaska. So you're seeing some of that. I think we're showing a very good growth for this year. Hopefully the increase is still there. Our revenues have gone up considerably since 2014 through the permitting process. Our fees have not went up, but our intake has been up considerable.
I have some questions.
Yes.
Thank you for the good work, and thank you for this report. Did you say that $4 million in reflection of project valuations does not include any airport?
That would not include the airport. Okay. The airport was within the second quarter report, which you had received in the last month.
Okay. The other issue I have is, the question I have and we need to think about is, there was a supposition at one point that the permit fees that we charge, the plan review fees, would recover the full cost of your time.
Yes.
So my question then is, do you think these fees are, we have a volume question as well, but you know, in order to arrive at the correct answer, we have to understand the effect of volume. But do you think that you're recovering the full cost of our city cost?
Closer, we are not recovering the whole cost. I do believe that our plan review fees should be increased.
Increased, okay. And how much, I mean, what percentage of the cost did we recover? And would be 2015 be an easier one to answer? Well, of the total revenues we realized.
Total revenues that we've realized, we've actually had an increase from over the past few years. This year, at this point, at today's date, we are actually up about $15,000 above where we were last year at this time.
So it's maybe a better question to ask. Mm-hmm. Of the $20,000 we collected, does that cover what percentage of your time, of the cost of your department?
I think it's hard to relate to when you have other duties.
I know that was a hard question.
That's a tough call on that point. When you relate to the zoning aspect of the job actually takes on more than you think, and a little bit of help that I do with the housing actually relates in there too. So it's a hard comparison. I don't know what portion of the job you could say.
Requires some analysis, and we do need to think about adjusting the fees, and now that we have additional administrative staff, perhaps we can arrive at a recommendation for the next budget period for a fee increase that's reflective of the costs that are being absorbed in this area.
Yeah, and the one that really wouldn't affect the normal general public, meaning the small residential projects, would be adding to the plan review fee. That would be a good add, which would actually add quite a bit of revenue just by going to what the state allows. It would help quite considerably without changing a lot. It's more for the larger projects, so you're not affecting the person that's doing some small project. It's more of the larger magnitude that you're going to see in that chart. I probably should have given you one more sheet, but just to look at the quarterly report at the beginning there, you can see the large increase in the plan review there. $1,700 here. That's basically because you've had larger renovation projects. And I can't remember, but I think we're about 15% light on what we collect according to what the state allows. So there wouldn't be that much of an increase on that number.
Does the state just use one measure for all? Do they divide rural and metro?
The state recommends a certain percentage of the permit for a plan. Considerably less. I think ours is, I think it's 15% difference for a commercial.
Other questions for Kelly? And just to be sure that I understand, the plan review fees of $1,775, is that included in the $18,000, or is that separate from that?
That is separate.
Separate. So you had about $20,000 worth of the.
Exactly. You're looking at $20,000 back to last year at what, $5,500? That's quite an increase.
Outstanding year. Outstanding year. Very well done. Further questions?
Thank
Thank you, Kelly, for that report.
Thanks, Kelly.
For the reports of the mayor, council, committees, boards, and commissions.
Just to put all questions at rest, at the next city council meeting, I will have my letter of resignation. It will be on our the first meeting in December. Secondly, everyone needs to come to the Christmas parade on Friday put on by the chamber because it's going to be super awesome. That's all I have to say. It's going to be super awesome.
Why, because of something special?
Well, yeah. because it gets us all in holiday cheer and get ready for Christmas. That's exactly why you'd have to go. It has nothing to do with the super cool floats that I'm putting together, which is two of them this year because I've upped up the ante and now I'm doing two this year.
You're not playing Santa Claus, are you?
No, I would never do that. All right. Not fat enough yet.
Okay. All right. Further on.
Yet being the operative word?
That is the key word. It's not Thanksgiving quite yet.
Further reports on council committees? Hearing none, we'll go to the audience. Anyone in the audience?
Oh, everybody.
Dan?
Public comment?
Please.
Good evening. A couple of subject matters here. The lodging tax is a funding for the Convention and Visitors Bureau. If it's a tax, then is that an entity of the city here and has its genesis as a result of an ordinance? In other words, what is the authority for establishing a Convention and Visitors Bureau? And I'm not from a critical standpoint, I'm from an understanding, a structure standpoint. Because right now, And here again, I'm not criticizing, you've got one entity there that's a taxing authority that's in the same building as a private organization as they conduct, say that they are. So if, is there anybody here that can explain that to me? Maybe Attorney Shimon could.
Let me take a crack at it, Dan, to start with. Taxing authority is established by the state statute. The Minnesota legislature and governor give local subdivisions of government the power to tax for lodging and Convention and Visitors Bureau marketing. That's the only the way that money can be used. It can't be used for infrastructure or something else.
So it is a part of the city then.
City and the county, local subdivisions. Both the city and county.
City and county.
Have adopted.
Okay. Because of that. All right. Then I have an understanding of that. Now, with respect to
maybe. City Attorney Shimon, do you want to add to that?
Well, I would disagree. There's specific legislation that authorizes this, and I'm assuming almost all communities now do it, particularly any that have any significant tourism. It's been in place for quite a few, I want to say maybe, 15, 20 years now?
At least.
Yeah.
Right, just because something was done a long period of time here, it's important to have an understanding of what the structure is here, because wherever you're involved in the expenditure of money, then that becomes a major question. There also is the question of accountability here. I have no idea at this point in time whether they're effective or not. They certainly put on a good program here tonight, but whether they're getting the bang for the buck or not, I'm not sure, but you answered my question, and I appreciate it. The second thing, I'm a paid-up member of the Chamber of Commerce here as an individual. It's my understanding that tax dollars cannot be used for advertising. I haven't seen a finalization here of a contract here, which I objected to here back in January of 2016 when we were talking about a contract that was submitted in 2015 for execution for this year under the various projects. I also objected to the type of contract because I've never seen one like that before in my life here for the amount of money that was involved. Although I had an opportunity to do the research on it because of commitments in other areas that come up that I had not anticipated at that point in time, I'm going to look into this. So I would caution the city government here to be careful in the area of getting involved in things that where it's pretty gray. If there's a small amount of money, I mean, what's really the basic difference? But I don't see a basic reason for a Chamber of Commerce which styles itself as representative of business, okay, to have over $100,000 in CDs here when they're coming to the city here to take care of their cash flow at the beginning of the year. And also, why is the Chamber of Commerce here sitting on that amount of money here? What's the purpose of it, you see? So I intend to do some further thinking about this, and I do, and I hope that I will have the time allocated to do the proper analysis and possibly even a recommendation here to the council at the appropriate time. I'm still at this point, but I have a lot of question marks about that particular issue. And here again, you get into the bang for the buck here. The structure of the contract was presented here, and there isn't a big difference between the one that is submitted in August of this year for 2017. Is voluminous as far as wording is concerned, and there's a real question of whether some of those things are real valid for city dollars to be used. If they want to use chamber dollars, let them go ahead here. But the membership dues that they calculated here for 1 year was about the amount of money that the city was providing. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, I have a question. Don't the auditors review, when they review our financial statements, they do review the legality of our expenditures, do they not?
I don't think that they do that.
I mean, if we were violating state law, would we know it?
I doubt it.
Mr. Mayor.
City Administrator?
If it's a, the auditors do a random selection of various claims and stuff that we do, and if it if the expenditure for the Chamber of Commerce would be one of those that would come up as part of their random selection, then clearly they would look at it to make sure that the expenditures for that are legal. And I received one inquiry from them on something else that they had some question on, and have posed the question to the Office of the State Auditor and haven't got a response back yet. So that is something that they typically would do, and I'm not aware of any concerns that they've raised at all in past audits related to the Chamber of Commerce contribution that we've made.
Okay, I'm just concerned that we follow the law. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Harrison.
Mr. Mayor and related members of the city authority here, I was just going to question the granting of this ordinance that you've okayed this evening. I'm not sure of the wording of it. 1954, vacating the ordinance of 370, and it says to be amended to allow the sale of all lots together. It appears to me that I've always had that authority. All lots together. So the only change that's made is just the steam pipes and things down the alley. So I've always had that authority, and now you've granted me that authority again. That I've something I've always had. At the time I had McDonald's restaurant was in the present. Could I pass these some of these papers?
Sure.
I'll pass some of the stuff around. I don't have enough for all the members, but. At the time, and this is what they requested, and then they stipulate of the situation.
You got enough for everyone, or should I pass?
Okay. For everyone, but anyway, here's a.
Had that one.
Okay. Anyway, I can pass these around. My question is, have I been granted anything new other than the ordinance of the steam pipes and different things in the alleyway?
Yes, the city reserved the right to be able to take and continue to put utilities down the alley by the ordinance that was adopted in 1954, and that's eliminated now. So you have the full property. The city no longer is going to extend any utilities down that alley, and so we're eliminating that.
Then it says here, be amended to allow the sale of all lots together.
No, that's the question. The city had the right to take and keep that alley open and keep it reserved for utilities, and we've eliminated that. Okay. So you now have the full property.
Okay, but in yellow it shows.
Pardon me?
Can he separate it though? Can he separate the lots?
It shows the McDonald's didn't want the whole property, they wanted partial property, and it shows there in yellow there.
Yes, City Administrator.
The way this shows here is that I wouldn't be allowed to do that.
Mr. Mayor, the language, I think, in the ordinance, as it was intended and as I drafted it, was to delete the two conditions in the original Ordinance 370 adopted, as you indicated, back in 1954. So anything that relates to that the lots should never be sold separately, lots 1 through 8 and lots 1 through 13, without adding back in a alley, has been removed from the conditions of approval. So the alley's been vacated and there's no more conditions. Those two conditions.
I have to sell all lots together.
What are you looking at there?
The first page of the ordinance, I guess maybe I'm wrong, but I'm reading it the same way he is. Section 2. Section 1 and Section 2 haven't been changed, have they?
Section 2 of the ordinance.
All these lots have to be sold together.
And that's just notes from the meeting that the chair had put together from the Public Works and Infrastructure Committee meetings. The way the ordinance is drafted is that the two conditions that were placed by the City Council as a condition of the alley vacation approval in 1954 have both been removed.
Okay,
so they're not in place anymore.
There's no restrictions at all?
Once it's published in the newspaper, that ordinance will go into effect and there won't be those restrictions in place.
This is not valid, what this is saying here. Lots have to be sold.
Well, I think that's just a general comment that the intention was is that you could sell them all together or they could be sold individually.
Because I've always had that opportunity
right.
to do that. So should something be stipulated to that effect?
We're eliminating that.
Pardon?
We're eliminating that wording.
But in here it says, you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah. I think I do.
Mr. Mayor, he's just reviewing the summary notes that you had made from the Public Works Committee meeting.
All lots to be sold together. McDonald's, he wanted to buy 40,000 square feet at one time, and then I retained the building.
You could either sell the lots separately, or you can sell them all together.
Or that's the way it's written?
That's the way it's written.
Okay.
Is that correct, City Administrator? City Attorney?
I haven't reviewed that. I'm not familiar with it, so I would defer to the opinion of the City Administrator.
Well, that's the City Attorney.
That's just a note at the top there that from the committee, a summary of the committee meeting.
Important significance is the wording of the ordinance, not comments that were made at the meeting. Or, you know, that indicates what the issues were, I think.
Have to go do a third reading too?
No, it's second reading, and as the City Administrator pointed out, it just has to be advertised now. The ordinance has to be published in the newspaper, and then it will be in full effect.
So if something were to come up in that somewhat similar situation McDonald's requested, that would be feasible to do that?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else in the audience that wish to approach the council at this time? Noted correspondence, and the next regular meeting of the council is December the 5th. We also will be having a special council meeting tomorrow to review at 1 p.m. the proposals on the comprehensive plan, and then we also have a special council meeting on December the 5th at 6 p.m. for the final budget and property tax levy. That we would stand adjourned. And next item
is EDA meeting.